Hi, and welcome to this episode of Sleep Like a Boss. So I'm really excited to have you here. And today we are going to talk about GABA and whether GABA can help you sleep. So for those of you who don't know me yet, my name is Christine Hansen. I'm a sleep expert to CEOs, athletes, and high achievers who want to sleep but can't. And my approach is to combine science plus mindset to have this 360 approach. And that is why today's topic fits in so well. We are going to geek out on GABA. I'm really going to dive deep into how our brain works, what the different transmitters do. And most of you will have heard about GABA as a supplement that will help you sleep. So straight from the bat, yes, GABA is a chemical in our brain that can help sleep. However, as always, the story is a little bit more complex to this. And so I'm going to explain to you why, and I'm going to explain why my approach is a little bit different than just saying, okay, here's the one fixed solution. I actually have quite a few people who come to me who have tried GABA in the past, and some say it helps a little bit and some say, well, it hasn't. And I just want to, you know, enlighten you a little bit on how things work. So if GABA arrives at the right amount, at the right part of the brain, then it can help sleep. However, if it doesn't, it can actually promote wakefulness and inhibit you from sleeping. And that's quite a big deal. So let me dive into that. And I have my notes here. So if I look to the side, that is why if you watch me on video, which you can do on my blog, sleeplikeaboss.com/blog, or on my YouTube channel. So the lesson of this, or the moral of the lesson, is already that the same transmitters can have different effects on states depending on where they are active in your brain. And so I'm going to look at different ones for sleep. So most drugs for sleep enhancement do feature GABA. And what they do is that they enhance transmission at GABA A receptors mainly, and also GABA B receptors, which means that it's easier to be received and to act at these particular receptors. Now, if GABA, however, is mainly reacting in the pontine reticular formation of the brain, and I'm just going to refer to this as PRF in the future. You don't need to know exactly where this is located. It's like quite in the middle on the lower end where you have this particular region. So if GABA is not necessarily being transmitted straight to the receptors A and B, but it's more active in the PRF region of the brain, it actually increases wakefulness and it inhibits your sleep. And we have seen this through animal studies, and where GABA has literally been inserted into the brain. The brain doesn't have pain receptors, which might help you to come to terms with this experiment, but they've literally inserted it in specific regions of the brains to see what it does, and they've seen this difference. Now, here's the problem. If you, for example, have issues with GABA being transported to your brain, which means that there are some blocks in your GABA being transported, you don't get enough. And if it's not basically flushed through so that you get a nice balance feed of GABA, it will basically mean that the sleep in that region is inhabited because there's not enough to be received. So that is one issue, right? The other thing is that the basic thing that you can remember is that if you block GABA synthesis, it is making levels go down and you can increase sleep, right, in that region. So if you block the receptors, you have two sides to this. You can have transmission issues or you can have receptive issues, which then increases sleep as well. And it also decreases wakefulness. So there's two stories. So basically, in a nutshell, if GABA is low in the PRF region, you will have better sleep and you will have more REM sleep. But if it is high in that region, you will have issues with sleep, and specifically in REM sleep. Why is this important? Because if you do take a sleeping pill, or if you do take a GABA supplement, and it has this reaction, because if you take this orally, we cannot control where it goes, it might backfire on you, right? Because we don't have the syringe that we can put into our brain. So it's this balance, and it's also this uncertainty, and having this one chemical that has different reactions that I want you to be aware of. Because if it arrives at the wrong region of the brain, it will keep you awake, and it's going to manipulate your REM sleep. Another thing that it does is that it messes with a chemical called acetylcholine. And basically what it can do is that when GABA A is blocked, acetylcholine rises. And when that happens, your REM sleep is also impacted, right? So you really, GABA can inhibit REM and acetylcholine, which increases REM. So both are really like, if the interaction is not balanced, you might be sleeping, but the REM part of your sleep is not as it should be. And that's what a lot of the time happens when we use sleeping pills. You will actually feel like you sleep a lot more, but you won't have as much REM sleep, and it's not going to leave you as refreshed as it should. So, and that's especially the case with benzodiazepines, which increase total sleep, but they inhibit REM sleep very often due to one of those reasons, because the chemicals basically mainly act in a region of the brain where they have an adverse effect very often. So I think that's really important to know, especially also because most of the time when we use GABA with kids, it will backfire. So for example, they've really seen this with anesthetics, that when they used GABA with kids, those started to become super hyper. So it had exactly the opposite effect as of what they had hoped that it had. So I know the chemistry of this is a little bit complex, but basically what you can remember is if the transmission is great and the receptors GABA A and B are well catered to, you are going to sleep better. But if they are blocked, or if it's received at too high levels at the PRF region, then it's going to inhibit your sleep and it's going to keep you awake. It also interferes with acetylcholine, so the REM sleep state is highly affected too. So I know this is confusing sometimes, but I hope that this little nutshell summary has helped. And my message to you is that if that balance is not working straight from the bat, if you are not sleeping, it's not because you don't have enough GABA in your system. And there is a reason why that is the case. And if it's not received enough, if there are blocking issues or receptor issues, then there is a reason for that. So the solution is never that you don't have enough sleeping pill in your system. There is a cause, and there is a reason why the amount of the chemicals might not be right, why the absorption is not right, why the balance is not right. And all of those solutions do not lie in a single pill, but they lie in looking at all of your body and in looking at all of the different factors that are influencing your neurochemistry. All right, so that's the end lesson of today. I hope this has helped. And I hope that this has given you a little bit of a message as to what my values are when working with my clients. But most of my clients know. The people who work with me, they don't want to rely on one pill. They know that the body is complex. So hopefully this has been helpful. And it's not just GABA. Every medication that you take has a side effect on sleep. So just be aware of that. All right, that's it for me today. Hi, Jogita. It's lovely that you're tuning in. And if you want to catch me live, just join me on my Facebook page every Monday. All right, I'll talk to you soon.